Welcome to my lecture online. In this video, we're going to explore the concept of power in the three-phase circuit a little bit more closely, and in particular, what is the average power per phase? Now, in the previous video, we found the equation that the total power of the load is equal to 3 times the phase voltage times the phase current times the cosine of the phase angle between the current and the voltage. Then we also noticed that the cosine of the phase angle, that's a constant, everything else is a constant in the circuit, and we realize that in the three-phase circuit, the power is a constant. Now, for a balanced system, we can then say that the power for a single phase is equal to 1/3 the total power, which therefore, we take this equation here, divided by 3, and we get the phase voltage times the phase current times the cosine of phi, the phase angle. So now we have some definitions here. P is the total power of the load, V is the phase voltage, P is the phase current, and then here we have what we call the power factor, the cosine of phi. Notice that the power factor goes to 1 as the phase angle goes to 0. And also notice that if we draw the triangle here, where we have the complex power, we have the reactive power, and we have the real power, the sub P simply means for a single phase. It would be the same if we took the total reactive power, the total reactive power, the total complex power, and the total real power. We have the same relationship. So notice that the power factor can be defined as taking the real power divided by the complex power. And of course, those will be equal if the phase angle goes to 0. Now here, again, for a balanced system, we just take 1/3 of that to get the phase power. And so we can define the complex power as being equal to the product of the phase voltage times the phase current. The real power is the same but times the cosine of phi, the power factor, and then the reactive power, the same thing but times the sine of phi, and again you can get those relationships from that triangle quite readily. We can also express the complex power in terms of the real and the complex part. So the real part is the real power, there's the reactive power, and we could also write it as the product of the phase voltage times the complex conjugate of the phase current. Now notice that if we write it like this, we really are talking about phasors, and that's not always clear, because in a book, we sometimes boldface the letters to indicate that it's a phasor, and don't boldface the letters when we indicate it's just the magnitude of that value. For in this case, you can see that the complex power in terms of a phasor is 3 times the complex power of a single phase, which is 3 times the phase voltage times the complex conjugate of the phase current. Again, those are then phasors, or we can write it as 3 times the, and this is the total, of course, so therefore 3 times the magnitude of the current squared times the impedance of the load, of a single phase of the load. We can also write it as 3 times the magnitude of the phase voltage squared divided by the impedance on a single load. So again, realizing that if you see a bold phase, it's simply the phasor format of the variable. This is the magnitude, and that's the phase angle. Now, we have to talk about something that otherwise will make it very confusing. Sometimes you see this equation right here. Now, notice here we're talking about the phase voltage and the phase current, but over here we're talking about the line voltage and the line current, and instead of using 3, we use the square root of 3. And you wonder, well, wait a minute, isn't the relationship between the phase voltage and the line voltage and the phase current and the line current, isn't that a factor of the square root of 3? And the answer is yes, but we have to be careful. For a Y-connected load, that is true for the difference between the line voltage and the phase voltage. The line voltage is indeed the square root of the 3 times the phase voltage, but that's not the case for the current. The line current equals the phase current. And for a delta-connected load, the phase voltage is equal to the line voltage, and the line current is equal to the square root of 3 times the phase current. So you see that in both cases, we only have to multiply times the square root of 3 once to do the conversion, and so therefore we know that the total average power, which is simply the sum of the three phase powers, is equal to 3 times the phase power, and when you express it in terms of the phase voltage and current, it is 3 times the phase voltage times the phase current times the power factor, but if we use the line voltage and the line current, the total average power is equal to the square root of 3 times the line voltage times the line current times the cosine of phi, regardless if you have a Y load or a delta load, and that's sometimes confusing, so we really want to point that out. And so then the two main equations we typically then want to use is that the total average power is the square root of 3 times the line voltage times the line current times the power factor, and for the total complex power, it is equal to 3 times the magnitude of the current squared times Z. Remember that typically when we talk about the impedance or we talk about the resistance, it's usually I squared R, and therefore we have that I squared Z in here, but times 3 for a three-phase system, adding up the three phases together. And so that gives us, hopefully, a much clearer picture of what we mean by the power in a three-phase circuit and the power per phase when it's expressed in terms of the phase voltage and current, and when it's expressed in terms of the line voltage and current. And there it is. That's how we know.